Well, we do have a junior high class. Blair has invited any high schoolers into that class. Yeah. Oh, very good. Kristen's got the third, fourth, and fifth graders. Good deal. Thank you, guys. Well, I'm at that stage of all the sinus and the weather moving out, where when I speak, all I hear is echoing in my head, and you may wonder, yes, there's a lot of room for an echo in that head of mine, and if I look at you like, can you hear me? That's because I'm not sure I can hear myself. But it's been a interesting study. We're finishing up the last of the discussion about the restoration, how God kept every single promise. These incredible prophecies are promises of the future, of course, and how God has kept every single one of them. We won't review all that. But the gentleman we're looking at right now is Nehemiah. He's a part of this last wave of pilgrims coming back to Jerusalem. This is a process that's been going on now for decades, and they have yet to put a wall around Jerusalem. And that is so important. Now, we don't understand it because obviously we're not in this time or this place. But if you had a wall, there was security for your people, for your culture, your community. If you did not have a wall, any group could come in at night, any time of the day, really, and if they could sneak in and overtake, poison your water supply, burn down your storehouse of food, so many terrible things could happen. So it was important to have a wall. Now, there's a lot of talk in our conversation today about a wall. These walls were not just simply a fence they put up. Jerusalem had a very thick wall, and there would be a gap after that, and then another thick wall, and it was designed to withstand a siege that could go on perhaps as long as a year. They would just wait out the enemy. They had stations all around on the walls so that they could always see what was coming from a long distance. So this is an absolute necessity for the well-being of Jerusalem. Nehemiah is just absolutely burdened. He has heard from his brother and from others who have come back, and they've talked about the progress being made, and it's very slow. And Nehemiah cannot believe there's no wall yet. So that is what has burdened him. Last week, we looked at this man because he was a man of prayer. He was praying. And he said, oh, Lord, you've got to help us. You've got to help us right now. And that's where we pick up the passage from that last verse in Nehemiah. And you'll find all the verses written on our notes today. And we're talking about the toolbox in Nehemiah, or the tools in Nehemiah's toolbox. We're going to pull out five things from this chapter, this first part of a chapter, where Nehemiah is using these same things that we can use today to see God accomplish something really good. So we start off with that bridge found in Nehemiah chapter 1, verse 11. And then, Lord, oh Lord, please hear my prayer. Listen to the prayers of those of us who delight in honoring you. Please grant us success today by making the king favorable to me. Put it into his heart to be kind to me. In those days, I was the king's cupbearer. There's been a lot of talk in the last few weeks about all that's happening in North Korea. And we know something of this leader. We know that he has absolute power. There's a lot of discussion on whether or not he's crazy or not, or whether he's sly as a fox. But there are a lot of things we know about this young man. One, that he has killed members of his family and hasn't even hesitated. We know that when he's killed them, he's been incredibly brutal. And if he wants to do something, he doesn't have to answer to anybody. He just does what he wants to do. Now you need to imagine a world where every king is like that. That's what it's like in this time period. And this is the most powerful of all the kings. And Nehemiah comes into his presence a number of times. Every time there's a special event, every time there's food brought in, Nehemiah is there. He's the cupbearer. That's a very important position because he has to have his ear close to the ground. He has to be able to hear everything that's going on. He needs to know if there's anybody who's mad at the king. He has to hear all the whispers about a conspiracy, because the easiest way to kill the king and not get killed in response would be to slowly poison the king. And all of a sudden he would get sick, and then he would slowly die, and nobody would ever know. The cupbearer's job was to make sure that did not happen. So he would bring in the cup, and he often, if it was needed, would drink the cup and eat of the food to make sure that nobody was sneaking something into the king's diet. So his job is very important. But it's also a very difficult job, because every day you're in the presence of the king, which means if he has a bad day and he doesn't like what's going on, and you knock over a glass or you say something or you don't carry yourself in the way, if he has a temper tantrum, it can cost your head. Now, do you remember back when Joseph was in prison? The cupbearer, the butler, and the baker were both in the jail. And why were they there? Pharaoh got mad one day, was having a bad day, and when he took it out on somebody, it typically took their head. So this was a very important position, but also a very difficult position, because every day you had to go in there and make sure that everything you said was just what the king wanted. It was your job to make sure you did not upset him. So that's where Nehemiah is. It's an influential position, but it's also very dangerous. So now we start with today's story. Nehemiah chapter 2, starting at verse 1. Early the following spring, in the day of Nisan, during the 20th year of King Artaxerxes' reign, I was serving the king his wine. I had never before appeared sad in his presence. So there's the big change in our story. The very first tool that we see Nehemiah using from his toolbox is the tool of waiting. A very important point here that says waiting time is not wasted time. You notice I underscored, "Please grant me success today," was Nehemiah's prayer. He had been praying that same prayer over and over now for 4 months. And the more he prayed, the greater the burden became. Perhaps you've been like that, to where you've just been overwhelmed by the need, overwhelmed by the heartache maybe that you're experiencing or someone else is experiencing. And the waiting is the hardest time. You feel like, "I need to do something." We even say stupid things like this. "Well, you need to do something even if it's wrong." Now, those of you that have felt the urge to do something and you've done something wrong, did it really help the situation? Of course not. So here it is. Sometimes we just have got to hurry up and wait. We look at our clock and we wonder, "God, what are you doing?" And we understand that God operates above time. Now, he operates in time, but he's well above time, of course. He sees what we can't see. He knows, obviously, what we could never begin to imagine. So here is Nehemiah. And this one day, he just cannot help it. It just shows on his face. You've seen that look, haven't you, at work? You say, what's wrong? Oh, nothing. And you say to yourself, I know there's something wrong. Maybe it's somebody in your family. And you can just tell by looking, the countenance is different. You just know that there's a burden that's weighing them down. So here Nehemiah is. Waiting time is not wasted time. For 4 months he's been praying. This is a verse found in a journal, so to speak, that Solomon writes. It's in Ecclesiastes chapter 3. In fact, that's an interesting book to read because there's a lot in it that's not really biblical. By that I mean Solomon is writing down his observations, and a lot of his observations seem to be true, but they're not. For example, he said, there's nothing in life. It's all empty. It's vanity. It's nothing but soap bubbles. They just float up into the air and pop, they're gone. There's no purpose to life. Well, we know that's not true, but that's the way we often feel. But all the way through this book of Ecclesiastes, you'll find these little gems where Solomon writes it down, and we can say, oh boy, that's something we need to remember and put into practice. Here is one of those verses, Ecclesiastes chapter 3, verse 11. Yet God has made everything beautiful for its time. Remember, there's a time for war and a time for peace, that passage. And here the writer says, God has made everything beautiful for its time. The writer says, I know there's a process. We understand that. We've all heard the story about the cocoon turning into the beautiful butterfly. You can't hurry that process. If you've ever been going out to your garden or perhaps out to a fruit tree and you see that first fruit and it's still green and you're so eager to pull it, to taste it, to see what it's like, but you know that if you pull it off too early, you have nothing but a green fruit that's good for nothing. You've got to wait. There's a process. The writer says, we know that in this process, God uses time to make all things beautiful in their own way. Says he has planted eternity in the human heart. We have a sense of that. We understand that there's more to life than just what's happening in these few short years. But here's the great conclusion that we look at for our lesson today. People cannot see the whole scope of God's work from beginning to end. If you are carrying a burden for a particular person or a particular situation, it is weighing you down. You feel like the answer is drifting farther and farther away. You need to be encouraged by this. God has a plan, and he can see well beyond what you can imagine. And because of that, there is a real value in waiting on the Lord. Not being afraid and doing nothing, but knowing that God has not given me permission to go forward. This is not the right time to reinvent the situation. It's not the right time to push and make something happen. This is the time to wait. Nehemiah found that to be the case. For 4 months he's waiting. So waiting time is not wasted time. Let her be. Waiting is the ability to do nothing until the command is given. How often has that been the case? Where the Lord, you know that he just wants you to sit still and wait. And is there anything harder to do than that? Not much, not many things. To just to wait. For 4 months, Nehemiah has been waiting. Lord, you've got to do something. I feel this burden. I've got to be a part of the process. The tool of waiting. We pick up the verse in chapter 2, verse 2. The tool of trusting. So the king asked me, why are you looking so sad? You don't look sick to me. You must be deeply troubled. Then I was terrified. We're going to look in a minute as to why he was terrified. Then I was terrified, but I replied, long live the king. How can I not be sad? For the city where my ancestors are buried is in ruins, and the gates have been destroyed by fire. So let's go back and ask ourselves, why was Nehemiah afraid? He's been waiting on the Lord to provide an opportunity. Now the opportunity is there. And even though it's the wrong situation, even though it's at the wrong time, we see that he actively is trusting the Lord because he steps right out and he talks about, yes, King, this is my problem. This is why I'm so worried. But why was he afraid? I thought this was very interesting. He knew that he was expected to be perfectly content just to be in the presence of the king. Subjects who were sad or melancholy around the king were often executed for raining on the king's parade. Well, that'd put a smile on your face, wouldn't it? You go in there happy. Oh, king, long live the king forever. You look great, sir. Oh, whatever I can do. Oh, it's no problem, sir. I mean, everybody is positive and happy. The king doesn't have to put up with anybody who is sad. He can just banish them from the palace. He can do worse than that, as we talked about the baker and the butler. There's a second reason why this was a very dangerous thing to bring up. The second was he was about to ask the monarch of the Persian Empire, the greatest empire in the world, to reverse a written policy he had made several years earlier about Jerusalem's reconstruction. This edict was recorded in Ezra 4:21. Now issue an order to these men to stop work so that this city will not be rebuilt until I so order. Nehemiah knew it would take the power of God to get Artaxerxes to change his mind. So you can see why this is so dangerous. O king, I am so sad because my city is abandoned. It has no protection. And really, sir, it's your fault. You want to say that to the king? Do you want to go to North Korea and tell that leader that it's his fault? Nobody wants to do that. But the Lord has opened the door. Nehemiah steps right through the door. Nehemiah's faith is greater than his fear. Being spiritual is not having any doubts. It's not about having fears. No, it's having faith that is greater than that. It's being so confident of the character of God, so confident of the promises of God, knowing that he is doing a work in your life and through your life, that even though you're afraid, you step out. There are so many very, very important ministries that are in operation today. Some even here in our church, where the person who initiated that said, I don't know what I'm doing. I don't know how to do it. I am not qualified, but I cannot shake this burden that God has given me. So I will go forward. And God does a wonderful work like that. He does a wonderful work when we are willing to go beyond our fear. So here he is. Nehemiah's faith was greater than his fear. Instead of paralyzing him, fear propelled Nehemiah to action. Months of prayer had prepared him for these crucial moments. So, two important tools that he's using. One is waiting, one is trusting. The third tool that he pulls out of this toolbox is the tool of praying. Now that was the emphasis of chapter 1, but we find here that it's a part of this breathing exercise that Nehemiah does. All day long we breathe. All day long this is what I do. I breathe in, I breathe out. We don't even think about it. For the Christian who is desiring to do God's will, there's an attitude of praying that goes on all day long. Lord, I don't know what to do. Lord, what should I do? Lord, I've only got a minute before I can make this decision. I want to make the right decision. Notice what happens here. The king asks, Nehemiah puts himself out there at risk. Lord, I'm sad because something needs to be changed. You made a rule and the rule is ruining my home city. The king asks, Nehemiah 2 verse 4, how can I help you? With a prayer to the God of heaven, I replied. Isn't that a neat example given to us by Nehemiah. He's been asked a question. He's got to answer. He cannot hesitate and wait 20 or 30 seconds. As soon as the question is asked, Nehemiah's response is, "Lord, what do I say? How do I say it?" This emergency prayer was backed up by 4 months of fasting and intercession. As Christians, we can do things wrong a lot. And most of the time when we do something that really interferes with the work of God, it's because we've sat down and we've thought up our own ideas about how this could be fixed. Oftentimes what happens is we're praying, we're waiting, we're praying, we're trusting, and then all of a sudden an opportunity comes up and you have just that moment to give the right answer. And we can have that assurance that God is going to give us the answer we need if we have been waiting and praying and preparing. That's what happens with Nehemiah. Look what happens here. You and I can pray at any time, in any place, by sending up a brief prayer to God right before we have to give an answer. Now think about these situations. Right before we give an answer to our boss, before you say something, you ought to send up a quick prayer, just like Nehemiah. Or before responding to your spouse. You and I both know that we have, unfortunately, the power, the potential to say something that can ruin a relationship, that can weaken a relationship. We have no excuse just to say whatever we're thinking, to let people know whatever we're feeling. No, we have an opportunity like Nehemiah to say, "Lord, before I say something, watch my mouth, guard my words." How about before you say something to your kids when you're disciplining them? How often we react to our kids in our discipline. And then we feel bad because what we've said and the way we've said it is completely wrong. And rather than apologize to our kids like we should, we act like it's no big deal. And then the bitterness begins to fester more and more and more. Before you say a word to your neighbor, before you're ready to share a word of testimony, Nehemiah's example is a good example. You pray. You've been waiting, you've been preparing, you've been asking God, and now the opportunity is there. Say, "Lord, what should I say?" And then open your mouth and begin, because God will do more than we can imagine if we will trust Him, if our faith will be greater than our fear. So the tool of praying. Now, the tool of planning, number four. The tool of planning. For 4 months, Nehemiah has been preparing for this moment. I'm sure that he's imagined it over and over. When I'm given the opportunity, what will I say and how will I say it? And there is a real need for us to plan, to anticipate, what does God want me to do in the future? Now, that doesn't mean that we can always know what it is and that we'll always guess it right. But if it's our commitment every day to say, "Lord, I want to be empowered by your Holy Spirit. I want to be guided by your Holy Spirit. Father, I'm going to read this book and I want you to teach me what your heartbeat is, what you want done. My to-do list is your will, Father." If that's our daily approach to life, that's our daily approach to the responsibilities of being a servant of God, then what happens is at a time like this, we are prepared. And here, Nehemiah is asked the question, "Well, tell me, what do you want?" If Nehemiah had said, "Oh, I don't know, I'm just so sad," it would have been a lost opportunity. But look what happens. He prays, and then Nehemiah in 2:5 says, "I replied, 'If it please the king, and if you are pleased with me, your servant, send me to Judah to rebuild the city where my ancestors are buried.' The king with the queen sitting beside him asked, "How long will you be gone? When will you return?" After I told him how long I would be gone, the king agreed to my request. I also said to the king, "If it please the king, let me have letters addressed to the governors of the province west of the Euphrates River, instructing them to let me travel safely through their territories on my way to Judah, and give me a letter addressed to Asaph, the manager of the king's forest, instructing him to give me timber. I will need it to make beams for the gates of the temple fortress, for the city walls, and for a house for myself." And the king granted these requests because the gracious hand of God was on me. He had been praying, and because he was praying, he was also planning. And then when the opportunity was given to him by the Lord, "Well, what can I do to help Nehemiah?" Nehemiah went right down through the list. Here's what I want. Nehemiah practiced both dependent praying and deliberate planning. That's why we have committees. That's why we have meetings. That's why we have business meetings. All of these things, they're important because we are praying that God will enlarge this ministry, that he will deepen this ministry, that he will give us opportunities to share the gospel with our neighbors, with this community. But it's not just a matter of praying, it's also a matter of planning. Lord, how should we be prepared for that? How can we do that? And that's why we're always asking you, if you have something that you want the leadership of the church to consider, send it to us. Give us a written piece of paper. In fact, tonight at our deacons meeting and staff meeting, there are a number of items on our list of things that we're going to be discussing. Ideas that have come from this congregation. Hey, have you ever thought about this? What about these things? Shouldn't we do this? And that's what we want to do. We want to be people who are praying, but also people who are deliberately planning. And that's what Nehemiah did. Nehemiah asked for and received three things from the king: permission, protection, and provisions. That's not a bad outline for us to use ourselves when we're asking an authority to do something on our behalf. He says, "Lord, I'm asking the king if he'll give me permission to do this, and then if he'll protect me on the travel and get the enemies out of the way, those who would seek to interfere, Lord, that he would move those out of the way. And then, of course, that I would have the provisions to do what you want done, Father." The tool of planning. And the last tool is the tool of testifying. He reaches in there, and here's what he says in chapter 2, verse 8. "And the king granted these requests." Why? "Because the gracious hand of God was on me," is the testimony that Nehemiah has. "When I came to the governors of the province west of the Euphrates River, I delivered the king's letter to them. The king, I should add, has sent along army officers and horsemen to protect me." Nehemiah was quick to give a testimony. "The Lord has done all that I've asked. He's done more than I have asked. This is happening." Nehemiah doesn't say, "Because I was so brave. I was so clever. It was because I manipulated the relationship I had with the king. Because I was working a deal." There's none of that. Nehemiah says, "This all happened because the gracious hand of God was upon me." Now, I'm sure that there have been times when you've been able to look back and to see things that were accomplished in your own life or in the life of your family or perhaps in a ministry, and you look back and you say, "I cannot believe that God would use me like that." Look at what happened, and it is because God was working through my situation and working through my words and the decisions I made. What a great feeling it is to know that we are part of something that has eternal value, that we are working in the Lord's kingdom, and that He is building His kingdom through the efforts that we offer as gifts. And Nehemiah said, I cannot believe how God has provided. His gracious hand was on me. This is my testimony. Nehemiah knew that what was taking place had everything to do with God's arranging and not human conniving. We can make a lot of things happen because we push and we shove and we push. But that is not the way the Lord does things. No, He works through servants, those who will do His will. And there's a great promise here. In fact, I shared it with Larry Gearhart yesterday. And if you've been in the hospital or you've gone through a very difficult time, there's a good possibility that I've shared this very same verse with you. It's one of my favorite verses. You really need to understand the setting because it fits perfectly into Nehemiah's situation today. For 40 years, Joshua has been walking with Moses, and he has seen Moses do incredible things. God has worked through Moses to bring water out of a rock, to part the Red Sea, and on the list of miracles would just, well, it would fill up a book. The first five books of the Bible. And all of these incredible miracles take place. And now Moses is an old man. He's 120 years old. And he says to Joshua, Joshua, I am going to die right here. I'm not going into the promised land. Joshua, it is your job to take these people into the promised land, and you're going to have to fight the battles to conquer the people, to claim the land. It's not going to be through some miracle. The people aren't going to disappear. Joshua, it's your job to lead into battle. And Joshua, understandably, is saying, what on earth are you saying, Moses? I can't do that. You know what these people are like. If they won't follow you, why will they follow me? There's no hope. And here's the verse. In fact, the same message is given twice in verse 6 and then in verse 8 of Deuteronomy 31. And here Moses says, do not be afraid or discouraged, for the Lord will personally go ahead of you. He will be with you. He will neither fail you nor abandon you. That is the testimony that Nehemiah has here in the first part of chapter 2. It was a very dangerous situation to share your heart, to show your feelings in the palace before the king and the queen. And yet the Lord opened that door. And when the door was opened, Nehemiah stepped in and said, this is what I believe God would want. This is what I desire. And the king responded and said, I'll give you all of that and more. And Nehemiah found out that the Lord went before him to prepare the king's heart, to prepare the people. Unbeknownst to Nehemiah, the Lord is preparing the city of Jerusalem for his arrival. There is a promise that we have that by way of application, we too can claim. And this is it, that the Lord goes before us. He personally goes before us. He prepares the way for us. Here's how I've often said it. I'm sure you've heard it from many other sources. Before you get to Monday, the Lord is already there and He's prepared Monday for you and He has prepared you for Monday. What a wonderful promise that is. Hey, let's pray and ask the Lord's blessing. Father, we are so thankful to see the way you work in the lives of men and women, and in this case today, how you've worked in the heart and the circumstances to accomplish your will, working through Nehemiah, working through the king. Lord, we're asking this week that it would be our testimony that many important and many good things take place because of the gracious hand, your gracious hand is upon us. Lord, help us to be like Nehemiah in the way we pray, in the way we plan, in the way we stand up without hesitation. Lord, we ask that you do that, that you'd work in us to accomplish your will. And we do pray for this because that's how you taught us to pray. The Lord Jesus said, pray for your will on earth as it is in heaven. And that's why we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Don't you wish you had that much fun in church?